por ahí.
So close to the end of the year, it just starts to get exciting, really. Starting to feel a little summery last week, and then a little wintry this week.
And it's supposed to be winter tomorrow too.
Oh, winter tomorrow too. So all a bit confusing. I think there's snow somewhere.
They're saying gale force rain, wind, and heavy snow.
Heavy snow. Yeah, no, that's just crazy, isn't it? Anyway, we are. I think graduation is scheduled for around like the 15th of December or something like that. So we've just got a little bit of time, but we've got a few processes to go through to get qualifications approved and things. So the two of you will be finishing up. And so we need to obviously get that paperwork all approved and ready for you to graduate. So that's exciting. Are you both intending to go to graduation?
What day is that?
It's usually on a Friday.
Is it the 15th or the
13th? No, I'm pretty sure it's the 15th, which is the Friday, the December. Anyway, I'll send an email about it, reminding people that that's a possibility. Go up there and have your moment of glory. Shake somebody's hand and smile nicely with the camera and have some nibbles and things afterwards.
Yeah.
Why not?
I'll be there. My students will be there.
Exactly. A good example for your students is a good example for the community. You just got to, it's a good way to celebrate. And it's great for everybody to see people coming out with these qualifications because then they know, wow, actually, maybe that's something I could do. Not that they'll be able to, because we're not able to enroll new students on these qualifications, but the new qualifications. Anyway. So, last week we looked at resolving problems and disputes and things in the workplace. Well, was there anything sort of particularly of interest that you took away from that class? What was the difference between procedural fairness and substantive justification?
Because it was procedural, even though they had grounds to fire somebody on a substantial fairness.
If they didn't
do it procedurally fair, it wasn't about, they weren't eligible.
Sure.
Yeah.
So you need both of those to take justifiable disciplinary or dismissal action. So substantive justification means you've got a good reason, so a sound reason. And so that could be, absenteeism or negligence or, poor performance, ongoing persistent poor performance, or, a whole range of those different behaviours that are negative that you could look at as the substantive grounds. But if you don't follow a fair process, then you won't have a good case for justifiable dismissal. And if you follow through with that, that employee will have grounds to come back and make a personal grievance. Can you remember how many days they've got to make a personal grievance? 90 days. Yeah, that's right. Or it can be extended if there's exceptional circumstances. So essentially, it's in the organisation's best interest to have, appropriate problem solving processes, like early stage problem solving processes. So that links back into the class before when we talked about performance management and making sure that we actually are, proactively managing performance on a regular basis, having those difficult conversations, picking up where poor performance is happening and doing something about it so that there's no surprises for people. And that, we bring that into, if there is going to be a dispute or a difficulty, then, making sure the organisation's got good policies and then good practices around that so that they actually follow through.
So I found it quite interesting because when you see, like they had a warning for doing one thing and then they get a warning for
something else,
and then a warning for something else, that there's not like the three warnings.
No. Not about three different things. It's about if you do three of the same bad behaviours. And it's not about having three is not the golden rule either.
Yeah.
There's nothing in legislation that says it's a verbal warning and then two written warnings and then you're out.
Yeah.
That's not set in legislation. That's set in employer policy. Okay. So, I mean, yes, the legislation says that we have to follow a fair process, and part of that is that people are given, you know, notice of what the issue is, an opportunity to improve support and guidance and training and development in order to be able to improve, and then, and so that's an ongoing process, and that verbal and written warnings may be a part of that, obviously, but that we need to make sure we note those down. But if you say in your policy that it's three written warnings and then you're out, then that's what you follow through with, basically.
Yeah.
So yeah, the legislation is a bit more open than that. But still, yeah, really important that we have that fair process. So, yeah. Okay, so any questions about what we did last week? Anything you need to know? Shall we move on then to tonight? So I said that, you know, I've broken rewards and remuneration down into two sections, two classes, because there's a lot in here. But I've given you all the handouts for it tonight. So if we don't get through all of it tonight, we'll do the rest of it next week. And you'll just need to bring the same handouts back. I don't think we'll get through it all tonight, but we won't try and hurry. We've got the two sessions if we need it. We'll just take it slow, because there's a lot involved in this topic. I think it's worth about 20% of your overall mark, so there is assessment relating to this. Oh, I didn't print you the assessment. Oh, I'll have to email it through to you. Learning outcomes. So for this one, it's about being able to develop an equitable reward structure from a given set of data and develop a base pay structure. Hey, you guys too hot in here? Do you want the aircon?
It's really warm.
Yeah, I'll turn the aircon on a little bit and then it'll be
I've been outside all day.
Yeah, if it gets too cold, just let us know and we'll sort it out. Hope it will help. Yeah, so firstly, we'll look at some job evaluation techniques. So how do we size the jobs? This is different to job analysis. I know it sounds really similar, and it's a similar concept may be involved, but this is about how do we size the job to determine how much a job should be paid. Okay, so that's, you know, information we need to know. We don't just pull that figure out of thin air. We have to come up with it somehow. And then we'll look at sort of equity issues. So a lot of this topic ties into motivation. How do we motivate people? And what sort of reward systems are we going to use in order to do that? You know, are we going to use pay for performance or bonuses or benefits or additional allowances? So we look at the sort of structure of that overall pay structure. Base pay structure, down here we'll look at grades, bands, midpoints and progression policies. Okay, so this is about how do we establish again what that system is for determining pay within an organisation, because organisations have lots of different methods for doing this. Do you know what sort of system your organisation uses? No? Yeah?
Yeah, it's variable performance-based pay and various passive qualifications.
Okay, yeah. We'll have a look at that. Do you have a moment? Do you have an idea?
Yes. Process? There is like different kinds of steps that we follow.
Steps, yep.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, so we've got different bands of pay and steps within those bands, and maybe grades within that as well.
Yeah,
so
that's the same.
Okay, so it's about how do we establish what those are going to be, and how do we establish what an individual gets appointed on that particular scale.
Yeah.
Okay, and there are lots of different approaches. What are we talking about here? Pay, remuneration, compensation. I always thought remuneration was spelled the other way around. I always got it confused. So understandable if you do as well. But compensation, the word compensation comes from a Latin word, which means to weigh against. So, you know, we're giving weight to the tasks that the individual is performing. And remuneration actually comes from a Latin gift with intense force, which is an interesting sort of origination for the words that we commonly use to discuss, you know, our pay. You know, some people talk about salary, some people talk about wages. And then we look also at the fact that it's often about more than just salaries or wages, it's about the total rewards package. So all of the little things that you don't necessarily count, because they're not coming into your paycheck, but they are additional sort of extras and bonuses for working for an organisation. Okay. Can you think of some bonuses for working for your organisation?
Well, on the dairy farm, you're on a salary,
yeah.
So you're not paid an hourly rate, wage, but you also get your accommodation and your housing.
Sure.
And that's like
paid
and deducted back, but it's not.
Yeah.
But it's still a reward. And meat.
And meat? Yeah, cool. Okay, good. Yeah, nice.
Yeah.
Freezer full of meat.
Yeah.
And buy a big freezer.
Yeah.
Oh, Jemima, what sort of.
Sick leave.
If you're out there working for yourself, you know, running your own business, you don't get sick leave necessarily, do you? You know, if you don't work, you don't get paid. So that's certainly a bonus that's worth quite a lot, you know, your sick leave, your annual leave entitlements. And they're all set in legislation, obviously, but then some employers might go above and beyond minimum entitlements. And some, you know, provide other forms of, you know, support. What, any perks to your job?
Well, we get paid an hourly rate, but then we get discounts of food,
mm-hmm.
and of alcohol, and of accommodation.
Nice.
So we should stay anywhere.
Cool.
Subject to
availability and
yes.
You know,
going in the middle of summer.
Canterbury show season. And you want to
sit down and for a meal, and there are five tours in there as well.
Yeah.
You don't expect to get sit down.
Yeah. So that becomes your total rewards package. And all of these things, you know, we go to work for lots of different reasons, don't we? It's not just about the money in the bank. It's a pretty big factor. But when it comes down to it, you're also looking at some of those other sort of motivators. So when we looked at theories of motivation, we look at theories of motivation. Learning, when we did the training and development. I said we'll talk about this again. Maslow's hierarchy of needs, remember that? Maslow's hierarchy of needs. We have those physiological needs that need to be met, so our base level needs. So long as we've got housing and food on the table, our base level needs are sort of met. So that's what your basic wage sort of salary should be able to cover. Alright? You know, anything, then our next step up there was safety. So, for psychological and physical safety in the workplace. Then we have belongingness, being part of a team or a group, a social institution. And we've got esteem, so that respect that comes from having a job, having a good job, and respect for self, respect for others. Okay, so status symbols come into that, you know, company car, company clothes, whatever. And then the top one, self-actualization. So that achieving your goals, achieving your ambitions, achieving your, you know, career, ideal career, whatever it is you're aiming for. Okay. So, you know, when it comes to rewards, you sort of start to look back at those theories of motivation and think, well, what is it that's rewarding for us in terms of work? And we break it down into two different categories. Have you heard of intrinsic versus extrinsic? Intrinsic is internal to self, so things that you come from within, so that feeling of self-accomplishment, that feeling of self-respect, it's self that comes from within, satisfaction of doing a good job, having a good job, those self-worth feelings are intrinsic to yourself. Extrinsic is anything that comes from outside of yourself. So here we are talking about pay and wages and bonuses and those sorts of things, but we could also be talking about, you know, thumbs up, employee of the month award, you know, even just a well done comment from your manager.
Yes.
Nice thing.
Yeah.
You know, so that's external to self. So each of us sort of have a different drivers when it comes to this, in terms of whether you're driven from these intrinsic feelings or these extrinsic ones. So activity one is just a wee questionnaire designed to get you to think about what is it that's driving you in your current job. So when you're done with the questions, there's a scoring system on the opposite page where you just add up your results from those three questions to give you the different ratings for those different aspects of, and it's broken down into more than just intrinsic and extrinsic. But thank you. external regulations, doing activity to obtain a reward. At the moment, you're extrinsic in my opinion, by the looks of it. Primarily.
Pretty much. It's not. It's a job, paying my mortgage.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. You need it.
And there's some pleasant things about it.
Yeah. It's good to know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
An unpleasant one, like my other pleasant at the moment. So.
That's good. It's not worth leaving just yet.
No.
These other ones, so the introductory regulation, identified regulation, and integrated regulation, those are also sort of part of that intrinsic side of the list of subcategories there as well.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, that's one.
Yeah,
I don't really do it.
You don't really do it for the paycheck?
No.
You've got quite a high intrinsic motivation as well. So there are different categories there. You know, the intrinsic motivation, doing it for its own sake because you find it inherently interesting and satisfying. Sure, that's an ideal world. None of you got too high on amotivation, which is where you are lack the intention to act or acting passively. So that's the opposite of motivation. That tends to come when people get a bit disillusioned in the job and maybe a bit dissatisfied and things haven't worked out, you know, the way they want, or they've been there for a bit too long and haven't seen the changes they want or about. But the external regulation is that more of the extrinsic side of it, so doing it for reward, doing the job for that paycheck. Introductory regulation is about, you know, it's about your emotional regulation, you're thinking about your own self-esteem and guilt, you know, you're doing it because you feel, you know, because your self-esteem, or because you feel guilty, you don't do it, you know, those are sort of emotional responses. Identified regulation, because you value its meaning, again, it's sort of intrinsic as well. And integrated regulation is part of your sense of self, so that becomes part of intrinsic as well. So if you're high in those ones, then you've got sort of relatively high intrinsic motivation for the work that you're currently doing. Just interesting to self-reflect, I guess, on what drives you. But also, you know, if you're working in HR and you're sort of responsible for setting up sort of pay and salary and reward systems, you know, you need to think it's not always about those extrinsic motivators. It's not always about pay. There's other things that add value to the person's life that are part of that total reward sort of package and the process. And it links in well with our theories of motivation. So equity theory is the belief that we need to put in appropriate ratio of inputs is going to be recognised appropriately. Okay, so if we put in equal effort, we will be acknowledged equally. So there's, you know, this is a lot about perception and how people perceive what's happening in the workplace, but whenever there's perceived inequity, it can lead to conflict and disharmony and demotivation, essentially. Okay. So we've got to be quite mindful of that when we are, you know, this whole debate about, the gender pay gap and things like that becomes quite, the equity theory becomes quite relevant there. You know, why are we paying similar jobs for males and females, and the female ones are generally getting paid less than the ones that would be equivalent for male type oriented jobs? Okay, so it becomes an equity issue. So yeah, we want to think that our input is going to be valued equally. Expectancy theory was Vroom and Yeager came up with expectancy theory. People act in the belief that a certain amount of effort is going to lead to a certain level of performance, and that that performance is going to lead to desirable outcomes. So it goes something like effort leads to performance, performance leads is going to lead to an outcome, and we value that outcome. What does that mean? Essentially, we try hard, it should lead to performance. Have you ever been in a situation where no matter how hard you try, you're not going to succeed? Yep, maybe. You can think of a scenario. So that means that this part of the equation falls down here. Okay, so if you think that no matter what you do, you're not going to succeed, you're not going to be able to perform, then we fail here. Then we need to think, believe in our minds, this is a cognitive theory, it's about how you think about what's happening. If you believe in your minds that if you perform, it's going to lead to an outcome. Okay, so if a finished product or a acknowledgement or some kind of reward, so a paycheck, for example, could be your outcome, or a bonus could be your outcome, whatever it is, that outcome has to be valued. We have to see that outcome as valuable to us. Okay, it's all good and well if you know you get that thumbs up from the boss, but actually if you don't value the thumbs up, you want money, then we're going to, you know, have weakness in that part of the equation.
Okay. And that can relate to a lot of different things. Even if it's not money, I know like my guys, like they put in the effort and they did all their work every day, and like when you ship the cows in the evening, I'd say to them, said that afternoon, okay, that's it, go have your family time.
Yeah.
Whereas the boss is more of, no, they should do that, but they don't actually get any family time either. They, yeah, it's not.
Yeah, so there's
that unmotivates them, then they're like, well, we don't actually have to go out.
Yeah,
watch
your good wins. There's no outcome that's valuable to us from doing it. So
yeah,
watch your good
wins.
Yeah, like balance could be the outcome that they get from doing the job, you know, in a good time frame.
Yeah.
Yeah, the afternoon off.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So it can be, yeah, it can be anything, it can be money, but it can be
other outcomes,
yeah.
Have a look at the example activity 2, Bob and his fish processing plant.